All right. So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lyndon Joseph. I'm a program officer at the National Institute on Aging and an exercise physiologist. We are here to discuss the importance of exercise and healthy aging.
Good morning. This is Luigi Ferrucci. I am the scientific director of the National Institute of Aging, and I'm very excited to be here talking about a topic that is very important for us, the effect of exercise for healthy aging. Researchers from NIA have studied this topic for a very long time from different perspectives. And one thing that is part of my job is to be the director of the Baltimore Longitudinal Study of Aging, which is a very, very long lasting study started in 1958 and following people over time. We have people that have been in the study for 45 or 50 years. And we have studied their behavior for a long time. And we can tell that physical activity and exercise, it's really, really beneficial to healthy aging. Now, those who exercise not only have better physical function, better balance, less risk of falls, but they also tend to have less chronic disease, cardiovascular disease. They tend to have less diabetes. If they have diabetes, the control of diabetes is better. They have less decline of their muscle strength. So really, exercise is key to healthy aging, and we hope that this discussion will help you making the right choices.
So great. So before we did this, we sort of did a survey and we had you send in some important questions. But we're going to be discussing results from, as Luigi said, the Baltimore Longitudinal Study on Aging and other NIA-sponsored study that looked at the effects of exercise and physical activity on health. But before we do that, we talk about exercise, and we know that a good segment of the population is sedentary. And as we increase in age, that percentage increases over time. So Luigi, the first question I have for you is what's the importance of exercise, and what sort of negative effect does a lack of exercise have on the physiology?
Well, there are many, many consequences of exercise. And, one of the things that exercise, help you burning calories. And you know that as you age, you tend to, accumulate fat. Your organism become less able to burn sugar and breaking down fat. And that is also have been some consequence that are really not beneficial. And for example, we know that people who do not exercise or are sedentary tend to have worse immune function and they have problem in their circulation. And for a reason that is completely unknown, they also tend to have more inflammation, more inflammatory markers in their circulation, which probably participate in affecting heart disease. And especially if you reach a level of obesity, not exercising, it could really be shorten your health span and also being associated with higher mortality.
So that's interesting. So there's some very negative consequences of being inactive. And so I guess the goal then is for you to become more active or to be getting an exercise program or increase your physical activity. And so when we talk about that, the question that people really ask is, well, what do you mean by exercise? You have to get out and do structured exercise, or can you just increase your physical activity? So one of the questions that I've been asked is what is the difference between exercise and physical activity? And as the exercise physiologist on the panel, I'm going to try to answer that question. And it is a very good question, because both exercise and physical activity has been used interchangeably, but there's a slight difference. Right? Physical activity, being physically active, is basically any sort of bodily movement that you move skeletal muscle and produces energy, so you move you around. But exercise is a type of physical activity, but it's a structured, defined repetitive motion, and the goal of that is to purposefully improve or maintain your physical fitness, right? As I mentioned, there's an overlap between exercise and physical activity, and that comes into play, especially for older individuals, because being physically active or participating in a structured exercise program, it improves or maintains your muscle mass, your muscle function, and your balance and your overall health. And it sort of helps to modulate these conditions that Luigi mentioned earlier on, diabetes, obesity, cardiovascular disease, inflammation. So being active sort of counters those negative consequences.
Yeah, it's very, very well said and very, very clear. And yes, it's important to understand that why we want to make the distinction between physical activity and exercise. You should not be afraid of the word exercise. You know, people think about jogging in the morning sweating or going to the gym and lifting, 30 pounds per arm. And I think that it's important to realize that even small exercise, starting small, can be extremely beneficial. In fact, in epidemiological studies, the huge difference is between being completely sedentary and having 15 minutes of physical activity per day, that it may not be structured, maybe just going to the grocery store or climbing stairs or doing some exercise in the house or working in the garden. That difference is enormous. And then, of course, if you exercise even more, you gain more. You know, your risk of developing cardiovascular disease is even more reduced. But you can get to a higher level of exercise slowly and progressively. And so it's important that you don't get afraid, you don't give up, because you think that, oh, this is impossible for me. You'll find that it's possible and it's enjoyable also on top of the impossible.
So the term baby steps is really important here. It's easy. It's better to start out slow and then build up as you continue. So to that point, one of the questions is why is it so important, Luigi, for older people to exercise as we age?
Well, research have shown that clearly there is direct effect on exercise, and I think Linda will talk to you more about sarcopenia later, but what you expect is that your physical activity will improve the way you move, your joint, your bones, your muscle. But there's also the very strong evidence that exercise and physical activity are cornerstone of healthy aging. Mental health can also improve. People use exercise as a treatment for depression, but I would say that it's even more powerful if you use it as a strategy for prevention of depression. You tend to be more optimistic when you exercise. You tend to be exposed to more stimuli around. And so one of the really culprits of old age, that is isolation and depression, can be strongly addressed by exercise. And as I say, many people feel that, if you ask to older people what they're afraid of, they will tell you that what they're really afraid is to lose their independence. Very few will say that they're afraid of dying. They will afraid of depending from others. And there is no better strategy that we know about that can prevent this disability condition.
That's some really great points. And I'd also like to add too, Luigi mentioned mental health and depression. There's been a strong connection between exercise and improved cognition. And from the perspective of clearly your ability to think clearly, to learn and remember things. And, being physically active helps improve and maintain some of these cognitive functions as we age. For example, the ability to switch back and forth between tasks, plan activities, and research from NIA have shown that there's certain areas of the brain that's responsible for memory and learning that respond to the exercise, and so that's very important. With respect to certain parts of the brain that respond to exercise, epidemiological studies have shown that the more moderate physical activity you do, the greater the increase in how your brain uses glucose as a fuel. And this is thought to reduce the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. Luigi mentioned earlier on, doing something is better than nothing. A recent study from NIA has shown that just routinely stretching helps in terms of delaying the progression of these memory problems we see with people with mild cognitive impairment. And so in that study, just stretching routinely a couple of days a week over a couple of months have slowed down this progression of memory loss that we see with people with mild cognitive impairment. And so there is a connection between exercise and brain health. The problem there is that we don't know how it happens, the mechanism behind this. But the good thing about this is that there's research that's being done to find out the mechanism so that we can use this as therapeutic tools going forward with regards to brain health.
This is excellent. I think that, use exercise to maintain our physical activity is extremely important. But what are the mechanisms, you think, that by which exercise also avoid, what I was talking before? What the mechanisms by which exercise and physical activity can prevent disability and frailty? Are they connected with cognition, or we think that are somewhat different?
Well, that's an interesting question, an important question, especially from an aging perspective, is that because as we get older, we become less and less mobile and become more frail. And up to about 30% of these individuals over 70 have a problem walking a block, walking a quarter mile. They have problems getting out of chairs. They have problems going up and down stairs. And one of the issue that research have found about this is there's a loss of muscle mass, muscle power, and muscle strength. This term was termed sarcopenia back in the 80s by Dr. Irv Rosenberg and Dr. William Evans. But what it does, it helps us to understand why we have problems with mobility as we get older. And it's important for functioning well and independent living, as we mentioned earlier. The good thing is that we know this changes with ages. It affects walking, it affects balance, it affects strength. But the good thing is that we know if we perform structured strength training exercise or balance exercises, it helps to modulate or decrease these progression as we get older. And so it's very important for us to be physically active, to maintain an active lifestyle, do some strength training, do some aerobic training, do some balance training. And also the combination of these balance, strength, and aerobic training is more beneficial in terms of decreasing this mobility disability that we see as we get old. So it's a combination of these training that's important going forward to increase your mobility as we get older.
I'm so glad that you're talking about different types of exercise. We are understanding more and more that mixing different type of exercise becoming very important. One example is that people ask all the time, what is the role of exercise in avoiding osteoporosis and risk of fracture, which is one of the important cause of disability with aging. And although we know that the resistant exercise, lifting weight or putting pressure while moving, it's an important component, the other component that are important as well. For example, you can walk, you can run, you can move in water. That's a perfect, very, very good way of exercising, avoiding overloading your joints. Last but not least, I think stretching is extremely important. One thing that very few people realize is that as you age, your joint become more rigid. You have your range of motion in the movement become less and less. When you try to reach, your back, it becomes more and more difficult. And so it's important that we learn some stretching exercise so that we can maintain that mobility and that range of motion. And that certainly, contribute to maintain good physical function. I think that one of the concepts is that you can start small and you shouldn't be afraid of starting. And starting smaller will help you gaining that pleasure that comes from exercising that will make you even more active and will add benefit to benefit. So, you know, I have a personal experience. I started exercising late. I started exercising because my soccer game was not good enough. And so, and at the beginning, I did it with a little bit of, you know, kind of pain. But that, as I did it, I started enjoying it. And, you know, many, many years later, I still run 3 miles every morning. And it's probably the best part of my day when I'm thinking, when I'm clear, when I'm in connection with people and with nature. So you should start small, but I assure you that is the best gift you can give to yourself.
So that's very important about starting small. And so I guess one of the questions that we have had is how much exercise is needed? And I guess I can answer that from saying that there's work out there that talks about activity-fitted physical activity guidelines from the Department of Health and Human Services, American College of Sports Medicine, American Heart Association. And what they've recommended is 150 minutes per week, it's about 2.5 hours. But you don't have to do, you know, it's about 30 minutes per day. You don't really have to do all 30 minutes at a time. You can break it up, 5 minute, 10 minute sections, because the goal, as we mentioned, is to get started. All right. And just so you know, for we talk about, you hear a lot about step counts. And for people who do, you know, this 10,000 step is a word that's been thrown out there, but you don't have to do 10,000 steps. There's work showing that people who do up to 8,000 steps have a decreased risk of mortality, 51% lower risk mortality for people who do 4,000 steps. And for 4,000 steps, you decrease the risk for people who do absolutely nothing. So you can increase your step over time to increase your physical activity. And you know, it's starting small and then working up. And as you get better and increase your fitness and increase your muscle function, then you can do for a longer period of time.
So think about your birthday. Give a gift to yourself and start exercising, and you'll find that there's no better gift that you can receive from anybody. So I wanted to help our, you know, the people that are listening to us. How do they start? What kind of resources are available they can consult, you know, at NIA and outside NIA, so they can receive some guidance and some example on how they can start, you know, their new life of being physically active?
Well, you know, there are countless ways to do that. We can go on the internet and get these, but there's a site called Elder Care where you can go and find out where in the area there's exercise appropriate for all individuals. You can look at the area agencies on aging. You can do your local community aging center or your local Y. But the important thing is to start somewhere, okay? One of the things we recommend is to set goals. You can set short-term goals. You know, today I'm going to go for a 5 minute walk. Tomorrow I'll go for a 10 minute walk. And then you can increase it that way. Those are the short term goals. You can also do long term goals. Like really, you mentioned your birthday. I'm going to start exercising. But you know what? My birthday is 6 months from now. And 6 months from now, I'm going to try to run a 5K, which is 3.2 miles. I'm going to swim a mile. So you can set short and long term goals to improve your overall fitness. And once that starts happening, you, as Luigi mentioned, you get the benefits of it, you enjoy it more, and maintaining that physical activity over time is what we're really looking for. So when you set these goals, then you can maintain it over time.
That's great. That's, I'm afraid, is all the time we have today. And we hope that you enjoyed this discussion and you tuned in. And this has really pushed you into a new life of exercise, and that will improve certainly your joy in the day. And then will also, you know, contribute to improve your health and quality of life. And it's been really a pleasure to talk to you today.
So it was nice talking with you. Please log on to the NIA website and get more information about how to be physically active.